أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وبه نستعين. الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ خلائق أجمعين، الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وخاتم النبيين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
صلى الله عليه
وسلم وعلى بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه المنتجبين. أما بعد، respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. First of all, welcome to this short course on Islamic theology, inshallah. And I am sure that Brother Bashir Rahim has introduced you the basic concept and methodology of this course. And I am sure that you are aware that we will be basically working from three resources on three levels. There is a book, of course, available in English, Theological Instructions by Ayatollah Misbah Yazdi, as a text, and video recordings of lectures of one of his students, Sheikh Ali Shamali in UK. He has almost, I think, 40 lessons and lectures to complete this course. And thirdly, I will be in service of our brothers and sisters as instructor, guide, study aid, help, and responding to your questions or your anything which is not clear for you or so on. So these are the three basically resources we will be, inshallah, depending in running of this course. Book, of course, is available, PDF is available, everybody can have it. I'm sure Brother Bashir will give it to you, or else if he's not given already. YouTube lectures or video lectures are also on YouTube available, and he has given to you. My side of participation or contribution will be basically to summarize those lectures, or maybe a little bit expand more on some aspects and angles which require a little bit more explanation, and answering, of course, your questions or clarification about certain aspect of the lectures. And therefore, basically, my contribution is, after you have already read and heard the first two resources, the text and the lectures by Sheikh Shamali. But today, as the first program in this series, I will, inshallah, briefly give you some background of this discussion and topic, which you may not find in the lecture or in the text, and also a list of or a synopsis of this whole course, and maybe a little information about his first three lectures, which you will be, inshallah, listening and reading and working on it until we meet again next month, inshallah. Okay. Aqaid, that is the topic. Or theology, that is the subject of our discussion. Theology, you know very well, the word theology is a Greek word, of course. It refers to knowledge about God. More in Christian terms, theology refers to knowledge of God. It is translated in Arabic by the word kalam. And kalam is not equivalent to theology, but something close to theology. Because again, the word kalam in Arabic or in Islamic terminology has different meanings. Sometimes we speak about kalam, which is, yes, discussions about Creator and God, but also at the same time, other relevant discussions about religion, all it includes in kalam. Sometimes kalam refers to a particular methodology and a approach in our discussion about God, about Creator and creation. Because there are, of course, various approaches or methods to discuss this topic or knowledge of God, which we will most likely little bit discuss today in the last part of our, or the last session of our discussion today. But again, sometimes kalam is used very broadly. Another word which is used, you know, which is maybe more accurate if you want to translate theology, is called ilahiyat. Ilahiyat. Ilahiyat means knowledge, exactly if I want to translate, knowledge about God. A knowledge, a science which discusses God. And again, that ilahiyat or knowledge about God is divided further into al-ilahiyat biman al-aam and al-ilahiyat biman al-akhas. Ilahiyat in general sense, ilahiyat in particular sense. Ilahiyat in general sense addresses the issue of existence itself. We exist. What is our existence? To understand our very own existence, the concept of existence. And that's called ilahiyat biman al-aam, or theology in the general sense. And then we have ilahiyat biman al-akhas, or theology in a particular sense or meaning, which refers to wujud and existence of God. Not just generally existence itself. No, existence of God. Anyway, so these are the different terminologies used for theology. In Islamic terminology and similarly in generally in the academic world. But then there is another very common word used for this same subject of the same discussion, which all of you, even you people, use it everywhere it is used, and that is called aqeedah. People show great deal of sensitivity about this word, our aqeedah. We are sensitive about our aqeedah. Theology is basically aqeedah. What is aqeedah? Aqeedah in Arabic comes from aqd, and aqd means to tie. Something like a knot. Tie is called aqd. Similarly, nikah, for example, the marriage is also called in Arabic aqd. Why? Because you tie a knot. You establish a bond and a contract between two people. Therefore, it's called aqd. In fact, any contract, even business contracts, are called in Arabic aqd, uqud. Whole chapter in it is chapter of uqud, the contracts. Why? Because you tie, you commit yourself to something. Why we call this particular issue aqeedah? Because we tie our life and our approach in life with this particular view or belief. Therefore, it's called aqeedah. We believe there is a God. We believe there is a creator. Because we say we believe there is a creator, therefore, we tie ourselves to this particular view. And those who say that there is no creator, they tie themselves to this particular view and belief. They don't call it aqeedah. Because when you say there is no God, basically there is no tie, there is no knot, there is no commitment, there is no one to commit, for example, in their understanding. But still it is a aqeedah, it is a theology, it is a view. So, therefore, aqeedah is the most common word used to, which refers to, again, theology. Naturally, when we are speaking about Islamic aqeedah, or Islamic belief, or Islamic faith, or Islamic theology, of course, we are referring to a very, very rich history of development of this particular science, which is responsible to explain to me and you what we believe as Muslims. What we believe. What we believe about what? What we believe about this world. If you listen to these lectures of Sheikh Shomali and read the book, you will find, and I'm not going very much in that line, because these first three lectures are very basic, very easy, very simple. There's no complication or any difficult challenges there. But basically, aqeedah is responsible to answer three basic questions. If I want to summarize, as you will hear in the video and also in the text, you will find that aqeedah or faith or theology or kalam is basically responsible to respond and reply to our three very, very basic questions. Number one, origin. From where we are? What is our origin? From where we are come? Number two, destiny. Where we are going? What is our future? And number three, what we should do? If anyone can really answer these three questions, problem is solved. Then the life has a purpose. From where we are coming, what is our origin? To where we are going, what is our destiny? And what we should do? That's it. Aqeedah, faith, theology is responsible to answer basically these three questions. Science of theology, of course, as I said, has a great rich history in Islam. It started, of course, very simply. It started, you know, very on a very simple basis. Well-known example, and I have in my lectures, and of course in this lecture and other places you have heard it, that when Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam conveyed his message to the people, he conveyed it in a very simple and basic rational basis. Well-known hadith that there was an old woman. She was busy waving, you know, that old style of waving cotton with the small thing which you rotate like that all the time. So Prophet passed sallallahu alaihi wasallam by this woman and asked her, why you believe in God? Why you, old, rural, uneducated, illiterate woman, Prophet asked, why you believe in God? She was busy rotating that with the handle. She stopped and saw that machine or small instrument is stopped. She turned back at the Prophet to say, this is a small machine. If I don't rotate, it does not move. How this whole world can continue moving without a mover? That's how I believe in God. Prophet turned back and said to the people, Alaykum bidin al-ajaiz. On you to take your deen from this old woman or old woman like her. Rational. Let me tell you something. Very simple example, but great philosophy and philosophical discussions can go around this very simple example. She stopped, she pulled her hand out that tire or that wheel exactly was moving, stopped moving, and she said, look, if it is stopped moving means nobody is rotating her, nobody is moving it. Simple example. Anyway, it started so simply, so basic discussion, but naturally as Islam expanded and philosophies, ideologies, different thoughts from different parts of the world started infiltrating toward Islamic lands and capital and cities and so on and societies, these discussions became more technical, more complicated. Islam arrived in a very illiterate, uneducated society of Mecca, but expanded across the world. And as a result, of course, you know, Indian philosophies, Greek philosophies, gradually their books of Aristotle, Plato and others were translated in Arabic, and other Indian philosophers, and others. Now, those philosophical, theological discussions, when entered Islamic arena, an Islamic academia, so-called society of that time, it created further discussions. How are we going to respond to these discussions? As I said, it started very simply. But now we have to answer and respond to this very much serious challenge. And in response to this situation, because Islam very quickly expanded physically and took over huge plains of land all the way to North Africa, to Europe, and in Asia far. So actually all these things started to come in, and naturally this debate and discussions about God, about our existence, about other issues, relevant issues, started to become very, very hot topics of discussions. And therefore, different approaches appeared, different schools of thought came up among Sunni broader school and of course the Shia. And in Sunni, of course, then naturally different schools like Ash'arites and Mu'tazilites and Maturidiyya and other approaches appeared. And of course Shia, or those who followed family of the Prophet Ahlul Bayt, they came up with their own understanding and responses to the discussions in the theology or Islamic Aqidah or belief or faith system. That made it quite complicated. Debates, discussions, and so on and so on. And this issue of Aqidah and faith, which as I said just now, initiated very simply, in a very basic way and fashion, became very complicated, and a particular science established to address this issue, which is called Ilmul Kalam, or science of theology. Okay, just this is the background I wanted to give it to you, that this science developed. Further down, of course, approaches in this discussion until quite late was more what we call it Kalami approaches. And Kalami approaches, which we can say theological approaches or Kalami approaches, are more based upon rationality, but basic rationality, and with the help of text, Quran and Hadith and Sunnah and so on and so on. Something like that. But later, much more pure intellectual approach developed again with the arrival of especially Greek philosophy and Indian philosophy and so on in the Islamic capital. More pure intellectual or deep intellectual approach developed, which is called philosophical approach in theology. Philosophical approach in theology, which is different than Kalam, by the way. And I don't want to go in that technicalities now, maybe some other time. But just wanted to give you a bit of a background. But sometimes Kalam is applied on both, but what I'm saying, sometimes the same discussions about God or creator and creation became very heavy intellectual, purely intellectual, without any assistance or help from any text like Quran or Hadith or Sunnah or anything like that, but purely depending on Aql and intellect, that is a philosophical approach which became of course very popular, very common, and more strong in responding to those who, for example, do not believe in anything or opponents to any faith or belief system. So that's a philosophical approach. Anyway, our approach, you will see, or Ayatollah Ms. Bayazdi's approach in this discussion is more inclined toward a philosophical approach. I will not say pure 100% philosophical approach, but it is also not pure Kalami approach, but it is basically more philosophical inclined approach, where intellect, independent intellect, is criteria. Because see, there's plenty of discussion spurred out of where we started. We wanted to answer a simple question: who created us? From where we came? What is our origin? But where these discussions reach, you cannot imagine. Because branched, and another question came up, another question, and that question resulted in another question. Question came up. You know, the whole issue, and therefore I say that important point which I made in the introduction, or the definition of Kalam or theology, al-ilahiyat biman al-aam, you know, or theology in a general sense. That is important, because now there are discussions which are not directly connected to the existence of God, but discussions around, general discussion. For example, what is aql? What is intellect? The whole when you started to depend on aql and intellect, and you say intellectual conclusions and intellectual discussions and intellectual arguments and so on, then the whole, somebody brought up this question, but who said to you that you can reach to the truth through your aql and intellect? So the whole discussion about aql came up, independency of aql came up. That is aql or intellect independently, independent from anything, can decide, can reach, can understand, can comprehend? These questions came up. So whole discussion about aql itself, of course, is started. Naturally, all these discussions are very important and interesting and has practical implication, you know, in our life, in our understanding of religion and deen and sharia. Long, far effects are there. I don't think in this course we will go that far, but just wanted to give you an idea that how this science expanded and so many other discussions came in this broader sense of theology. In the first lecture, now let me just quickly come to the first lecture. Now in the first lecture, if you look at the first lecture, basically it's also introduction, and then there are some akhlaqi basically issues addressed, you will see. And it's very simple, I don't think I need to discuss or explain further. The first point which he makes is about the definition of Kalam, which I already explained, in fact a little bit more in detail. Then another point which he makes is that you must know that knowledge itself is not sufficient for salvation. If you know something, does not mean that you are successful, you are done. No. If knowledge is without amal and action and deed, you know, it is not. It's just knowing that all of you know smoking is harmful, but still you continue to smoke. Who is there who does not know that smoking is harmful? Who does not know that sugar is, you know, smoking is great? Sugar itself, for example, is very problematic. Myself including, love to eat sweet things. But, so knowledge itself is not a rescuer alone, if it is not along with amal. As I said, More akhlaqi aspect is discussed in this first lecture. Another very important point discussed, which I think crucial in our startup course, also akhlaqi point, basically ethical aspect, moral aspect of knowledge. That a lot of people think that if we know something, we have to do that. But if you don't know, we are okay. That's terrible. That's, that doesn't work like that. You cannot run away from responsibility by saying, because I didn't know, I didn't do. No. You didn't know and you didn't do. You have two problems. Why you didn't know and why you didn't do. So, by just avoiding knowledge and by just avoiding, a lot of people say, no, I don't want to go in these discussions of deen and the religion, there is a God, there is one God. If you go in there, you get stuck there and then you have to do this and you have to do that and you have to follow that. Better not to know that. Let's not go there. Easy way out. No, there is no easy way out. You know or you don't know. The reality does not change. For example, if you don't know smoking is harmful, it does not mean that smoking will not harm you. Still it will harm you. So that is another aspect, of course. But at the same time, when you know, that's another very important angle. When you know, your responsibility becomes greater than that you don't know. Does not mean that you should say that I don't want to know, you have to know. But once you are knower, when you are alim, you are, you know about something, then your responsibility is even greater. He quotes one very beautiful hadith and you will hear it, but I can. For myself, I would like to read, which says that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah forgive sin of a jahil or ignorant before Allah forgives 70 sins of alim. Allahu Akbar. The last or one or two other points which are in the first lecture, if you see, refer to another issue. Knowledge is important. Amal, practical deeds are important, crucial, yes. But also, here we, little bit above rationality we go, that not only knowledge and action, but we require what we call it tawfiq min Allah. We require support from Allah. That is the conclusion of this discussion, inshallah. We are saying it now. You must understand, when we are starting this discussion, you should think that you are atheist, you are non-believer, you don't believe in nothing. From that 0.01. Okay. So, but for a minute, let's go back where we are and our intention in this course. Remember that knowledge is something in our understanding, Islamic understanding, is like a noor, al-ilmu, noor. يَقْزَفَهُ اللَّهُ فِي قَلْبِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. That Almighty Allah's nur, it is ilm, is a light which Allah enlightens heart of whoever He wants to enlighten. Al-ilmu nur. Anyway, naturally, among different knowledges, there is no knowledge, no science more important than this science of Aqidah and this science of theology. Last point, why? Because whole approach in your life, whole direction of your life depends on the foundation which is Aqeedah. If you believe in God, you will act differently. You will live differently. You will look at things differently. If you don't believe in God, naturally, you live differently, you look at things differently, your direction will be different. Everything depends on this knowledge. Your whole life, your destiny, your approach, everything depends on this, you know, basis and foundation, which we call it Aqeedah or theology or faith or belief system. Salaam ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
In second lecture, if you look at it, you will find the topic. Why? Okay, now this is the introduction, that's it, and there are some definitions which you can easily read in the text or also listening to the Sheikh Shomali's video, it will be clear. The world view and ideology. This is, I have in fact indirectly mentioned, but very quickly, world view refers to the our view, what we think about this world. Ideology is how we should behave in this world. But sometimes word ideology also applies on worldview. And other some terminologies are explained, you know. This worldview again is further divided into basically two groups. A worldview which is based upon faith and belief in God. There is a creator. And worldview which based upon that there is no creator, this world came result of accident, you know, series of actions and reactions, which is called material, of course, ideology or material worldview, in contrast to the divine worldview. You know, another way of putting it is that metaphysics or physique means that does anything exist, something beyond this physical world, which is called metaphysics, beyond physics, beyond what we can sense by our senses, or no, only material views. So that is the two basic groupings, of course, exist. Or the two main camps are material and divine in worldview or ideology. The second lesson takes discussion to another very important point. Now, this was, as I said, background discussion. Now, we will start discussing topics one by one in a particular order. The first question or the topic is why we need to talk about religion. Yes, no, you have given background, that believe in this, don't believe, but why we need to get into this? Why I must not go get money? Why I must not do something else in my life? Why am I waste my life and time in religious discussions or religion? Why we need to speak about religion and think? And here, you know, couple of reasons or arguments are given, which we will discuss quickly. Again, it's a detailed discussion. I will not be able to summarize, I will not do it in explanation because, as I said, we are supposed to do it post. But today we are doing before you, going to read and listen. So I am most likely will give you a list or just give you an idea of what it is. You will listen, you will read, inshallah get a bit more clarity. Three main arguments. Number one, nature. Nature. In one simple word, we have a curious nature. Human being, we as a human being have a problem. I would say a problem, which is called curiosity. We want to know what? And this curiosity is sometimes very big trouble. Whatever we see, whatever we experience, we want to know why, how, where. And sometimes this curiosity ends up in big trouble. For example, somebody you saw him somewhere. For example, one of your friends, you saw him coming out of a, for example, club, pub, something like that. Oh, he's coming out of pub. Why? Oh, started scratching. This is natural. Now, Sheikh Shomani have explained beautifully that sometimes this curiosity is problematic, sometimes it is not problematic, but it is has no benefit for us. It is there. I want to know everything. For example, sometimes people want to know who they are, their ancestors. A lot of discussion is there that who was my grandfather? Now you could, for example, go in great length and discuss. My grandfather came from Germany, you know, from France, and my mother was local, and then, you know, she was what type of local, and India, and I don't know that, and which part of India, and which village, and you go, some people go all the way looking. It's curious, you want to know. But end of the day, what is the point? Okay, your mother, father, grandfather, grandmother, they were from wherever they were, so what now? What difference it makes? It's a curiosity. There was a person in Prophet Prophet's life, a lot of people were around him. Oh, he was like, you know, very popular. A lot of people surrounded him and told him. Prophet asked, who is he? Yeah, oh, no, big alim, no, biggest scholar. Oh, asking who? What biggest scholar he is? He is Nassab. In other words, he knows family trees. He knows your origin, you know, from which tribe you are, where you were living, where you migrated. Prophet said, what knowledge is this? Does not help dunya nor akhirah. It does not bring bread and butter, neither it brings anything in the Qiyamah. What knowledge is this? Anyway. So, but curiosity is there. Our nature of knowing, our nature of curiosity pushes us to a very basic question. Not to ask about who was our grandfather and who was our great-great-great-grandfather. No. But to ask or inquire what is our origin. Means not origin in a sense of me or you as an individual. No. Origin of our creation. Who? How we came in this world? How we got stuck here in this world? This question. And, of course, The second question which I already mentioned to you, where we are going? What is it? After all this up and downs, where are we going? Where are we going to go? What will happen to us? Is this world going to be just like that? Or will reach to a particular conclusion? What? This is a basic question. It has a great effect. And how we should live or behave in this world. Again, same three basic questions. Three basic questions. The Khoja Madam, the Khoja Miravan. In Persian, a poet very beautifully says that the whole philosophy of life is hidden in these two questions. From where I came to where I'm going. If I know what is my origin, and if I know where is my destiny, I will know how to live. How to live in this world, how to behave. If I think that there is no origin, then I don't have to worry. And if I think that there is no destiny, it's just going, one day finishing with it. Then I don't have to worry, then I will live without any sense of responsibility. Responsibility, Masooliyat. Responsibility comes with the answer of this question. Who created me and where I am destined to head in. So this, if you want to answer this question, you have to study religion. Even if you don't believe in the religion, doesn't matter, you have to be religious. No. Because religions are claiming. Why I'm saying religion? Because religions are claiming that they can answer to these three basic questions of yours. So, even if you don't believe in the religion, but you have to listen to them. Okay, don't believe. Don't necessarily verify them, accept them. But you have to listen. Because all these religions are claiming and they are saying, we got answer for your questions. So you have to speak, you have to talk, you have to discuss, you have to inquire. As I said, detailed discussion is there. Second reason or argument why we should have religious discussion or discussion about deen or theology or aqeedah or faith or belief, whatever you want to call it, is a mathematical argument. Mathematical argument. Argument of probability. Very, very really important argument. It's a mathematical argument. This argument says as follows. There are two groups of people in this world, right? Materialists and those who believe in divine. Materialists say nobody created us, no God. We are going nowhere. We will die, finish, you will become dust, sand, finish, rust, go, nothing. Two people, right? One say, no, God has created you. God has given you responsibility. You are responsible for your action. There is a qiyamah, there is a hereafter, there is hell, there is a paradise. If you do this, you will be punished. If you will do this, you will be rewarded. Okay. Two opinions, not third opinion. There's only two opinions. Now, the question is that if we follow a religion, or if we don't follow a religion, what is the scenario, mathematically talking? If we don't follow a religion, there is a possibility that nothing will happen. We will die, our body will become finished, nothing will happen. So what? You will enjoy the life, do whatever you want to do, that's it. Second possibility. What is the second possibility? That the people who were talking from religion, they were true. Now, if we live a life without any inquiring about religion or going into this discussion, we will be in serious trouble. We will be in very, very serious trouble. Now, Qayamat is, if happened to be what these prophets have said, these religions are saying, after death you have to answer this, if they happen to be true, oh, we are in big trouble. How are we going to respond? So we will be in big trouble. Take the other way, the other possibility. If we did research in religion, investigated in religion, followed religion, and happened to be untrue, will we lose anything? We won't lose anything. So what? Let's say those materialists were right. So what will happen? Nothing will happen. Finish, whatever. We didn't lose anything. But if religions were true, we will be, of course, the winners. So if you follow religion, you are successful in both cases, in both possibilities. There is no probability and possibility of harm or problem or trouble. But if you don't worry about religion at all, you don't think about religion at all, yes, if one of them came out true, that materialist, yes, of course, you'll be okay. But what about the other 50%? If they came out to be true, then you will be in very big trouble. Now, that discussion, again, you will hear it, but more mathematical, those will know in more detail, it says. And now, in mathematics, they say probable and probability. Probable and probability. Let's say probability is 50-50. Probability is 50%. 50% maybe these materialists are right. Nothing. Oh, nothing. Nothing exists. 50%, let us say, that religious people are right. No, there's a world hereafter exists. There's a accountability exists. There's a question answer exists after death. Right? 50-50. So, probability is equal. But probable, muhtamal, is not equal. Oh! In the first case, what will happen probable? Nothing. You will die, finish, nothing. In the second case, probable, if you did not follow religion, if you did not do what you were supposed to do, if you did not believe what you are supposed to believe, you will be in eternal problem. Hum fiha khalidun. That probable is too big, too pricey, too high, too risky. So maybe even probability is 50-50. But probability is very high, very expensive, very risky. You cannot compromise. So you cannot say, I will not talk about religion, I will not discuss religion, I will not investigate, I will not inquire. No, I should try, it's worthwhile, not worthwhile, it's very important, very risky. I can be in really serious trouble. Plenty of examples we can give, you know. A lot of people say that maybe my brother, you always got a stomach problem, you're complaining always, your stomach is sore, something is here. He said, no, I'm not going to go for tests. He said, why are you not going to go test? Maybe they will find cancer there. So you go or you don't go, cancer is there. Risk is too high. Probable is very serious. Implication of that. Maybe 50-50, correct. Maybe it is, maybe it is not. But the risk of that 50%, the probable of that 50% probability is very high. This results that we must, we should, we cannot avoid investigation of religion, inquiring religion. That is second reason. Third reason, let's take a small break and after that. Salawatullah Muhammad.
from